This program features live coverage of an African safari and may include animal kills and carcasses. Viewer discretion is advised.
Jumbo, 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 everyone. A very good afternoon. We are here in the Masai Mara, the Mara Triangle, and welcome to your afternoon live safari, live from the African wilderness. Jumbo, jumbo, everyone. A lovely afternoon we have here, and already at my place here with four lions or lionesses and lion right below the Olololo Syria escarpment. It is quite beautiful. The weather is just perfect. And as you can see, the sun is still shining. There's no rain today, so it's a promise for a beautiful, thrilling afternoon. There I have Olalashe. Sorry, it is Kijana. Kijana is one of the main males in the Olololo Pride. And in Olololo Pride, we know now there are seven lionesses and two males. Jumbo, my name is Isaac, and on camera I have Bungay. This afternoon, our mission is to find the lions, and I've started with the Olololo Pride. Apart from that, we're going to be looking for many more things. Remember to talk to us on hashtag WildEarth. Questions and comments are really, really welcome. You can send in also your kids' questions at wildearth.tv and also at FC. The weather this afternoon, we have 27 degrees Celsius, and chances of rain are about 40%. The weatherman sometimes predicts for the whole place, but it can be very localized. Looks like it might not be in our area, and I hope so, because it is a lovely afternoon to be out here. Yeah, that is Kijana, and we estimate Kijana is around 5. This is the age that actually they start taking over prides, but he is very, very lucky. He was taken in by Olalashe, who is much older, and he is the main male of this pride. He's been, you know, they have mated with all the females that we have in this pride, and so in the next coming months we expect a lot of small lions. Let's take you to another live location where my colleagues are waiting to introduce themselves.
Good afternoon and welcome to an extremely hot day here in Djuma Private Game Reserve. 41 degrees Celsius and 105 degrees Fahrenheit. Yes, it feels like the sun has fallen out of the sky and landed in Djuma. But the elephants have made the right call. They've came to the waterhole to splish splash about. My name is Lauren and I do have Kurt on camera today. And we're going to sit here as long as we can and enjoy these elephants. I'm extremely jealous that I'm not in there with them. The hippo's also jealous. Look at this. A little bit of a territorial display there by our resident hippo. Taking a bit of a tantrum, he really doesn't like it when the elephants come to his waterhole. But sadly, there's nothing he can do about it. Okay, so we've got a youngster coming towards us. Is he gonna turn away? Yes, he's turning down. I just had to be sure that I didn't reverse there. And with these temperatures, everything, including ourselves, are going to be seeking shade, water. So of course, water holes are the best place to go. But I believe there was a little bit of a sort of rumor this morning that two leopards, one male and one female, at least their tracks were seen together in the Mulwati. And there's thoughts that possibly two leopards could be mating. So I think it's worth going into the Mulwati as well. It's nice and cool in there and see if we can spot any spots. Oh, we've got more elephants streaming. They're all coming from Central Road. Oh, I wonder if this is a different herd or a same herd. Once herds get too large, they split. But of course, they all need water. So normally around a water hole, you won't find too much aggression. Everyone can share a large water body like this. It could also be one herd. Or it could be a kinship group. That's when they used to be one herd, but the numbers just got too large, too unsustainable, too many bodies, too many mouths, too many tummies. Therefore, it's safer and more sustainable. Oh, hippo, okay. That was a big yawn. Someone is not happy. So elephant herds can split, and they split into two separate herds that we call kinship groups because they're still related and they will still meet up with one another from time to time because they are relatives. There will be no animosity or ill feelings between the two herds. One's gone swimming though, I must say. They've just sort of splish-splashed, spraying, drinking, but no one's actually gone in for a swim. Can you hear the woodlands, kingfisher? The never-ending sound, this will be the rest of summer. That's a very territorial display from this bull hippo. You see the helicopter whirring off the tail whilst defecating, another territorial display. And now we're going to submerge ourselves. Oh, and we're going to do a belly roll. That was lovely. Water aerobics. Big grey mammals everywhere. Maybe this is the one herd, and these are just the stragglers at the back. And of course, they can remain in constant communication with one another. So they could be chatting. They all know where one another are, what's their positions. Who's lagging behind? Who's up front? I was at a woodlands kingfisher having a bath. Do you see that there? It's just gone behind that elephant. Oh, I think it's away now. I think it was a woodlands. Birds need to cool down too. There's only so many ways birds can cool down. And dunking their bodies in the water, not fully, partially, is definitely one way of doing that. This is the same herd. That herd in the distance over there walking away very, very rapidly. They're not entirely comfortable that there's other elephants in the water. Okay, so we're going to sit here and be extremely jealous of these elephants cooling down in the water while we are not.
Good afternoon, everyone, and a warm welcome to the side of Ngala. My name is Tim, and behind camera we have Big James. I am on a mission, and this time my mission is to find a cheetah or maybe the big group of elephants that always roam across this savannah. But at the moment it looks all clear, so heading to close to the Mara River where they always exit from to see the big numbers. So because of the rain, find that there's lots of grass, there's lots of water, so sometimes they take a little bit of time before they walk out of there because there's more food to eat. So I'm just driving slowly to see what else I can find. There might be sabo, leopard, or maybe the cheetah that I'm going to look for. Temperatures are lowering down, so I'm expecting to find more game and also nice activity. Because of the grass being tall, I have to stop for a little bit to scan around. This is when my binoculars get into practice. So I have to check in the long grasses because you never know what's hiding there. Oh, there's a lone warthog there. Oh, but they're very shy, especially because of the long grass. They never wait. I see the tail up. So when the warthogs have piglets, that is one sign that they use as a follow me sign by sticking their tails up and never wait at all. Very shy, and because they're very small, short legs, so they're always wary of predators. And off he goes in the long grass. So I'll still carry on to look for more. And on my mission, fingers crossed, let me take you over to another live location.
Good afternoon to you from andBeyond Phinda Private Game Reserve. We have just found a few zebras after coming to the floodplain here to come look for a cheetah from this morning. My name is Diewald, and behind the camera we've got Craig, and we're going to be spending quite a bit of time around this this floodplain here and see if we can find a few more other animals. We could see some white rhinos and so in the distance as well, but for now we're gonna just spin zebras. And I think these zebras have been on WildEarth before, because in this particular spot there's a stallion that's got his head there in the long grass that is actually doesn't have a tail, and he's been in this area for quite a little bit, and it's interesting that you can find different individuals in different areas and identify them by these features that they've got. I remember a couple of weeks ago this particular stallion and his herd of females and little harem actually chased Cheetah and her youngsters into some thickets on the same floodplain. He's really enjoying that bit of longer grass that's growing down there. Actually stretching his back legs out far while he's feeding. Maybe he's a little bit lazy to walk closer, so he's stretching out with his neck. Quite funny. But have a look at that little stumpy tail. Oh, it's just moving the whole time. You can imagine it must be quite frustrating trying to flick the flies away with your tail, but there's no tail to do it. So I'm sure you've seen it before, and how zebra stallions can fight quite hectically when it comes to fighting over fillies and their mares. And this one obviously lost his tail in the process. A lot of biting and kicking happening. Feel the wind picking up and cooling down a bit. It was a very hot and humid day, but we do have quite a bit of thunderstorms that's rolling in the distance. I think these animals are really enjoying this cool breeze that's coming over this open plain. Rosalind, you're asking how many zebras there are on Phinda. I'm going to lie to you if I tell you that I know exactly the exact amount, but I'm sure there is at least a few hundred zebras on Phinda. Just where we are, standing up, just look around my shoulders quickly. There's probably in the vicinity, there's probably around 30 or 40 alone, and that's just this one little spot. If it's not close to 1,000, I'm sure there's a few hundred on Phinda in this particular area. See the two standing right in the back there, they're actually standing and resting. And one of the ways to see that they're just standing and resting there is that's inside. You can see he's actually taking some weight off of that one back leg there. Almost like what the elephants also do sometimes when they rest with their one leg up in the air. But for now, I think Craig and I are going to keep on driving around on this floodplain here. With it, like I said, with it cooling down, a lot of the animals I think are going to start to become a little bit more active. Maybe see if we can track that cheetah down that Kim had this morning.
Good afternoon and welcome to andBeyond Ngala. Myself, I'm Yapi. Behind the camera, we've got Sebastian. And we are currently driving straight towards a very big storm. If you look straight up ahead from us, there's a huge anvil-shaped cloud. And that's a very clear indication that there is rain on that side. Now, that's not on Ngala, and from where we are at this part, we can actually see the storm develop and move around us. Now, normally with weather like this, it changes things a little bit up. It makes animals quite active, actually, especially cats. And we haven't had any signs of cats this morning. No lions were found, so what we actually hoping for is maybe we might luck out with a storm. Now we're in the western part of the reserve, and it's a part that we haven't driven a lot lately. And this area is slightly different from what we used to driving the areas around the Thimbivati riverbed. We're actually quite far and a little bit higher up. And in between there's a lot of, even though it might look like it's quite dense, there's a lot of clearings hidden away in and amongst the thick bushveld here. And that's where large herds of impala gather, herds of zebra, as well as some wildebeest. And they are the ones that attract the predators. Eventually we'll make our way around to a large watering hole. And I was hoping that by some luck, we might come across a herd of buffalo this afternoon. You can see the sun's hidden away now by the clouds, which cool things down a little bit, especially with a steady breeze going. And I'm hoping because of that, we might find that some animals might move out of this shade where they would have spent the warmer parts of the day. And we might get to see them out in the open. So I think we'll continue and hopefully find some fresh signs of something.
Well, good luck. Here I have one of very secretive and nocturnal antelope. It is the reedback. We call it Bohor Reedback. And it's very, very shy, very secretive. Right now, it's staying still, hoping that I can leave so it can lay down. Spends all its day hiding in places like that. That is a man-made, what we call meta drain from a small culvert here. And that's a perfect spot it's found. It's a young foal, not fully grown. So the adults are somewhere. Bohors are found in wooded and open savanna. There are not very many, and mainly it's because of their behavior. Hiding like this, if you run, normally they run, and without looking, they just get into a bush and hide. Leopards and lions find them very easy to pinpoint and kill, because they can stalk them, find them, and kill them. Of course, they can run really fast. Look at those hindquarters, equipped for leaping and accelerating. They can run really, really fast. And it's a grazer, feeds mostly on grass. And you find males with a harem of up to 3 to 4 females scattered within an area. Those big ears help them detect any threat approaching. It's one of their most useful sense is the hearing. They have a gestation period of about 7 months, and we rarely get to see this size because they don't do very well. I'm wishing he could turn so could see his face, but staying still like that is a, you know, it's a mechanism they've developed to try and just, he's listening to something, just stand there and hope that, you know, you don't see them. You think it's a log or it's a rock. That's why they stand like that. They freeze but he is, you know, he or she is listening. Males have got very interesting horns. They point forwards, unlike most antelopes that are always, you know, bend backwards or sharp straight or spiraled. Theirs are so interesting. They point forwards. I've never seen two challenge one another, but it's one very interesting antelope, Bohor reedback. We do have other species called the mountain reedback. They're much more grayer and they have a thicker coat. You slightly find them in higher altitude. I don't know if I move slightly if we'll be able to see the face. It's quite a cute face. Yeah, there it is, the face. Look at it. It's hoping that I can go away. And fully grown adults can weigh up to around 50 kilograms, so they can be very heavy. That is what they do. They lie down for almost the whole day, only getting active very late in the evening and early in the morning. Of course, I think the best thing to do, because he wants to have a peace of his mind, I'm gonna leave him, because I also wouldn't like somebody to really disturb me when I'm trying to hide. Yes, I'm gonna continue on. I have some elephants, we'll be showing them to you shortly, but let's take you to another live location.
So we took a bit of a gamble. Once the elephants left Rotella Dam, we thought we were going to come to Galagopan and just sit in the shade, which has been delightful, by the way. And they're here to drink. This is a man-made pumped pan, and the water is clean. The water at Gowrie Dam contains lots and lots of poop and nutrients and algae, and it's muddy. It's not clean. And elephants really, really like and look for clean water. They're all going to come streaming in. Elephants are very, very fussy drinkers, and that's why you find them digging with their trunk in the Mulwati to get clean water. So I think I'm just going to go quiet for a little bit so we can hear them splashing and quenching their thirst. You normally say herd for a group of elephants. Now, if you do see some people in the background, we are in front of a lodge. So they're all drinking around Galagopan, which is in front of the lodge. So if you do see humans, they're sitting at the viewing deck. Normally say a herd. To be honest, I love collective nouns, and I really, really enjoy a bloat of hippos and a cauldron of bats and a dazzle of zebra, but actually they have no scientific basis whatsoever. A collective sort of group of animals, this is just a herd. And these funky collective nouns that we get are lovely, but really they don't have sort of any scientific basis. So this is a herd of elephants. And it'll be a family group. There'll be a matriarch, the oldest female, it's not always the largest. It's not wise to think the largest will be the matriarch, although generally the older you get, the larger you get, it is directly correlated. But it's a bit of a mistake to think that the largest one is the matriarch. It really is. You've got to study a herd of animals before you can really sort of understand who are they following, who's the leader, who's the one giving instructions. She'll be the oldest, but it doesn't mean she'll always be the largest. The matriarchal role in an elephant herd is absolutely pivotal. They can't survive without their matriarch. And you will find that all others in the herd sort of gravitate around her. You just need to watch for a short while and you'll be able to see that everybody gravitates around their matriarch. And the loss of a matriarch can be so, so destructive for a herd. Just in that fold, Danny, in that fold will be the opening of the elephant's ears. Elephant's ears are, of course, extremely large for thermoregulation purposes. But in that fold, right at the side of their head, behind their eye, in there, you'll have the ear opening. It's a very, very small hole. Just like ours. Ours is quite small. And those big ears act like satellite dishes. Channel in the sound. You just can't see it from the folds of skin. But going back to the matriarch, the death of a matriarch ultimately means the loss of knowledge and care of the entire herd. The matriarch's knowledge is so crucial, critical to the survival of everybody. Mostly ecological knowledge and culture. She passes everything down to those in her herd. Must be passed down through generations. Everybody's gonna walk past a car. Now, a good matriarch, they have to balance the needs of the family members so that they can stay together. And the amount of time that a herd spends together, believe it or not, is based on the degree of conflict. Elephants can have conflict with one another. So the matriarch has to balance everything for the survival of the herd. She has to resolve conflict. She has to intervene, scold. There's costs and benefits to staying in a herd. The costs, of course, are putting up with one another. You've got to put up with everybody. They might get on your nerves. You've got to do what everyone else wants to do. There may be conflicts, but we're gonna try and stay with these elephants a little bit longer and I'll come back to the benefits.
Very warm welcome to this magical part of South Africa. Good afternoon, my name is Carl and behind camera is Big D.
Hello.
And thank you very much for joining us this very special afternoon. Lovely little steenbok. Very rarely they just stand and give us the luxury of observing them. They're normally very fleeting animals. So this little one standing still like this is quite a treat. So myself and David decide to go northwest for this afternoon and we're going to go hang around in a very beautiful area. It's one of my favorite spots and the idea dawned upon me while I was making my way to collect David this afternoon, of how beautiful and how vibrant the silver cluster leaves are looking. We actually have a section in the northwestern sections of Tswalu that has a, you could say, a mini forest of these terminalias. And we're going to go scratch around there because they're flowering at this point in time, and hopefully you can find some insects in and about the trees. And it's also just a spectacular place to be in. It's warm, but it's cool, which is very, very lovely for us. We're going to send you off to one of our other colleagues, and we'll see you once we get to the terminalia farm. Oh, wow. Did you see that?
Well, I have a beautiful herd of mixed grazers, eland and zebra. These ones have allowed me to get close enough to see most details. This is the largest antelope we have in our plains here in Masai Mara, but usually very, very shy and always tries to get away from us. Looks like that lady there did something to her horns when she was much younger and it grew that way. Definitely it's a deformity that occurred after birth. It's not natural for them to be like that. And they're quite a good number. All these are females. Males tend to be slightly, you know, bigger build, and you can tell sometimes their color is slightly darker. The eland is very widespread in Africa, from sub-Saharan Africa all the way to southern Africa. And that is a bull. Look at him. You can see the difference. They grow to be very, very big. The only predator out here is mainly lion. But breeding herds with young ones sometimes are actually outmaneuvered by hyenas and leopard and killed. I don't know why he's following the zebra, or he wants that patch where the zebra was eating. Yeah, looks like he's displaying. They grow very thick necks, and also it becomes very hairy on the forehead and on the side of the neck. You see that? And then that dewlap, I don't know what he's doing. He looks like he's wandering around. I don't know if there's a female he's trying to follow, or maybe he's leading everybody to come. They weigh up to around 1,000 kilos, and although they're that heavy, they've been known to jump up to 9 feet in the air with ease. If you look them out, you will see pictures of them jumping over vehicles, so they're very good jumpers. They can trot for long distances, but they're not very fast, but they can trot very long distances. And they're quite successful because they're grazers and at the same time they're browsers. So when there is plenty of grass, like this time of the year, they are enjoying plenty of it. And when it diminishes or sort of starts drying, they go back to eating leaves. They do migrate in the annual migration, but their numbers are not well defined, estimated to be around 20 to 30,000. Not forgetting the striped one, you see it there, bachelors, or the common zebra. We have other species spotted all over Africa. I would like to see the Chapman zebra, the mountain zebra in southern Africa one day. But here in Kenya, we have the gravies found up north. But here, the most common one is this one, Bachel's zebra. They go in small, what we call dazzles, a dazzle of zebra, and it can be one stallion, a few mares, and their foals. It looks like there's a few very pregnant. They carry their young for up to around a year. And zebra, surprisingly, is one of few animals I know that they're always pregnant, even when suckling. Well adapted to living in this plain. The plains they have incisors both upper and lower, unlike most other grazers that have got either only lower, and on top is always a hard pad. So they are able to graze even on the shortest grass found in any plains. And they are not ruminants, they are hindgut fermenters. So it means their food takes a while to go through all the intestines, but it's one of those animals that fully utilizes almost everything. Their droppings are so fine, like a horse. It's a beautiful afternoon here. And that is the kind of view nature has provided. I hope you have a word for it. It's very beautiful. Over here right now, looks like my animals are not worried or disturbed by anything. And so they are at peace, grazing and browsing. Also, you know, all these animals, they are water dependent, and so they need water. The water is easily available. It's not very far. So they can always, you know, go for a drink somewhere. We have oxpeckers on top of one eland. You see the oxpeckers on the male eland. They're always on top of them. Of course, you know, oxpeckers don't go in all animals, but eland, buffalo, giraffe, impala, you'll always find them, you know, trying to get something to eat, sometimes even using the animals to drink water. When I say drink water, is they will find animals going for a drink and they'll come very close to the nose. So when the animal is trying to drink, they can also have an easy reach of water. And every time it goes up, they swallow, and every time it goes down, they drink. Quite an adaptation that they've learned to do. The tree you find there is called boschia, and it's one of the dominant trees in the plains. Nothing much eats it, but it's hollow and provides lots of, you know, animals with refuge. Bees, monitor lizards, squirrels, hyraxes, you know, geckos, rock angamas, you know, all those species of animals and reptiles seek refuge in that tree. So it might look dry, nothing much eats it, but it plays a very big role in hiding many critters, including the lilac-breasted roller. I have seen a lilac-breasted roller actually nesting in one of these trees. So it is a tree that looks dead, but that's how it is. Such a beautiful sight. It's been so green in the last 1 month because we've had plenty of rain, and looks like our short rainy season is just coming to an end. That's why it's so green here. The hills you see long ways, you know, you see those ones? Those ones are in G Money. Can bull elands kill leopards or lions? I hope that's the question. Yes, they are very dangerous with those horns. If cornered, they will go for anything, and they don't go down easy. And so they will kill a leopard, they will kill a lion. They are those animals that don't dare even try. Fully grown eland is very dangerous to a lone leopard. So they go for young ones. Lions also do try, but they don't go down easy. They fight. And those horns, if they get hold of a lion, definitely they will leave the lion with a lesson or kill it. Yeah, beautiful male bull there. Just enjoying his afternoon with the cows. They have a gestation period of 9 months, and they do give birth always just after the rains. We do see lots and lots of young ones, or just before. That's the main time. Otherwise, where there's plenty of grass and browse and graze, they give birth year around. And they basically are not threatened. And this herd here has been so good to me this afternoon. I cannot believe it. You know, normally they take off. I don't know if the first humans did something to them because they're always shy. But this herd here is quite comfortable with us. They don't go into the pachydam category, because I think pachydams, we count from around 2,000 kilos upwards. And also they don't have a thick skin, so they don't rank in that category. Looks like I'm gonna leave them and try find something else. I don't know if there's something else over there. Well, you know, this is very beautiful. And when I look with my binoculars, I don't see anything else, but yeah, I'm gonna try and move on and thank the eland. While I do that, we're gonna take you to a quiet moment of nature in another live location.
He had an elephant. It was standing right over there. It's gone behind the bushes, as you can just about see its ears as it's flapping. We are not staying at the waterhole at the moment. We are doing a bit of an adventure because we're hoping to find a lion somewhere around in these parts. Earlier today, we did bump into one, hoping to find it this afternoon. Hi, everyone. My name is Mike. Behind the camera is BK, and you've joined us at Eco Training's Pride Lands Conservancy, where, as I said, we were looking around this area because earlier today, one single young lioness was found, and I'm hoping that it might be Lagatha, that lioness which we used to see quite a lot, the young female who loves the area around in Lovig Dam, around our camp. We haven't seen her for a while now. We're just driving around this area. There's a lot of buffalo, a lot of elephants around, which could have disturbed her quite a lot. But hoping that she's going to pop out somewhere, maybe as the sun goes behind the clouds and it gets a bit cooler now. Very, very humid. There's a real weight in the air. I really think that we're going to expect some rain maybe today or tomorrow at the very latest. Hopefully some this afternoon, just to bring this heat down. 40 degrees right now. That elephant isn't sticking around, though. It's gone. We're going to sit here and just wait. It's actually quite a good time to just listen. Animals might be coming down to the waterhole. We're not so far from the water. And we did see lots of zebras, giraffes, wildebeest, and impala at the waterhole earlier. If they spot a lion or any other predator, they will alarm call for us and we'll be able to hear it. Right now we can just about hear the Cape turtle dove. Where is it, though? BK, can you see it?
No.
I can hear it very loudly, but it's not coming out for us. I wish I could show you the clouds right now. I don't know, it's really difficult. They've flattened out quite a lot, so it's not easy to see. But early on, we had some incredible clouds called Mamatis clouds, which you should look up, because they're very cool. I don't have a picture of one, unfortunately. But it basically is it's a cloud with a very rounded, very smooth but rounded base. And that is basically a mass of cool air resting on some warm air. And if that breaks through, we end up getting heavy thunderstorms. It did not break through, however, and we've got this incredible humidity as that cold air just sits on top of us. Right, what I'm going to do, I'm just going to take us slowly along this road, because I think it's a good opportunity for us to investigate. What else might be wrong? There's a lot of sweat bees around, that much I can tell you. They are busy trying to land on my face right now, trying to get the sweat, which they will use to keep themselves hydrated. I don't know, BK, will you be able to see this spider web over here? You see the spider web? Just over here. That's pretty cool. So it almost looks like a bit of a community nest spider web. So the spider itself is probably living somewhere inside. It's not a community nest spider web, but it looks a bit like it. It's probably living somewhere inside of this stump. And what will happen is anything that crawls nearby to the entrance touches on this web and the spiders will emerge. Now, it could be a community nest spider of some sort, maybe not the normal one that we normally see. It looks a little bit shabby, this web. Maybe it's not being really well kept, which could mean that the owners have abandoned it or that there's just not many. But basically, things will touch on these strands, which are quite sticky, and then the vibrations will... Oh, look, the elephant's pushing a tree down. Oh, it was a bit too strong for him. That is actually a leadwood, I think, that it's trying to push over. No, it's a marula. So the elephants will do that, not only to try and knock down fruits, but also to push it over to get to the roots of the tree, which seems unnecessary at this time of year now, because there's plenty of good stuff. But look what it's doing, reaching up into the tree to try and grab some of those branches. It might do it again. We actually saw an elephant push over a really large knob thorn. I think it was yesterday or day before yesterday. It was really spectacular. I mean, if I was to take, you know, 10 of the strongest people that I know and we all pushed together on the tree, there's no way we would even make it shake. I could even hook a Land Rover up to it and try and pull it. We'd do nothing except maybe damage the vehicle. But the elephant, this one, didn't manage to push it over, but I'm sure if it kept going, it would have. They just kind of build momentum. They rock the tree back and forth, until enough of the roots start to snap and loosen in the soil, and the whole thing comes down. and they'll feed on it for about 15 seconds before moving off. It always seems kind of wasteful, but nothing is wasted in the bush. Everything gets used in some way by this animal or that. The elephants got what they needed. Other animals, like impalas, might then feed on the leaves that are now available to them, the kudus, animals that might be using the roots to... Oh, well, he's going to try again. Look at this. Oh, my goodness. He's almost got it. That is a massive tree. Oh, my word. He just came at it from a different angle, and there goes a huge marula tree. That tree might have been 50, 60 years old, growing slowly, avoiding all the predation to finally make its way into an adult tree. And that elephant decided, you know what? I like the look of you. I'm going to try and move us forward slightly, BK, so maybe you can get a bit of a gap there. So we can actually see this elephant. I think you'll be able to see through there a little bit. Tell me what you think, BK. Yeah, that's a bit better. Not, can't see too much, but you can see the tree that it pushed over right next to it. Do you see that? It's actually snapped the tree right off, which is even more impressive because wood is some of the most resilient materials that you can imagine. I mean, a tree is designed to survive nature's worst. You know, wind, storms, rain, whatever nature throws at it, the tree usually can survive. The elephant has proved that with a bit of persistence, anything is possible. And now it's feeding on that tree. Now, another thing that might happen, and I don't know if this would affect it, but I know that trees can raise the tannin levels in their leaves to reduce predation, right? So tannin is a chemical in leaves that's very bitter. And what they'll do is they'll pump the tannins into the leaves and make them very bitter, and it's quite toxic, in fact, in high doses, and animals will end up leaving the tree alone. Now, if it snaps the tree completely off like that, is there some sort of disconnection that happens? Will the tree still be able to do that? Will this tree still be able to pump up the tannins, or will it just not even bother because now it's basically going to die? I don't know. Maybe it's a technique that the elephants have to try and avoid that so that it can just feed at its leisure. Man, oh man. That was really impressive. And here I was thinking that elephant was going to be so difficult as it walked off into the bushes, but it provided us with an amazing insight into the typical life of an elephant. Now, what often people say when they come to Pride Lands is, you know, there's, for one, an abundance of large trees, much larger than they normally are found. And we always say that's because they've been, you know, for 80 years or at least 50 years, they've been separated from the Kruger National Park and from elephants, and so they've been able to grow without predation. But then they also say that there's a huge number of trees that have been pushed over, which is exactly the same reason. Elephants have come here because of the abundance of trees and vegetation, and they start to push them over and damage them, as elephants do. And if you look at some places adjacent to Pride Lands that have been connected to the Greater Kruger National Park for longer, there's a lot more open areas. And so what's happening now is these elephants are going to slowly bring Pride Lands into more of an equilibrium between grasses and trees and animals. Because right at the moment, Pride Lands is quite thick in many places. So the elephants are just providing a bit of a service. They are keystone species in some aspects. And a keystone species is something which stops anything from becoming dominant, stops something else from becoming dominant. So they will stop trees from dominating the grassland by opening up patches. But they'll also feed on the grass in huge abundance in the right time of year. See, it's still flapping its ears triumphantly while it cools off and eats. So now often I've seen, I don't know if animals see it or if they hear it, but sometimes, especially in the winter, when there's not much green vegetation around, an elephant will push a tree over and you'll hear this loud cracking sound and you might not see it, but then all of a sudden all the animals, impala, nyala, kudus, all start walking gently towards that area, because as soon as the elephant moves off, they will start to feed on all the fallen leaves and fruits and whatever they can find. Which I always find really, really fascinating.
Welcome back on board here on Tswalu Kalahari. Wonderful sighting we have here while we're making our journey northwest. Beautiful leopard tortoise. And what a better suited animal to be within these harsh and dry conditions or environments. Very well suited to arid regions of Southern Africa, or South Africa especially. And this being one of the most abundant out of all tortoises that we find on the terrestrial base in South Africa. Obviously here they'll be a little bit smaller in comparison to lusher areas like the southern and eastern parts of the country. And it's also the largest species that we have. These individuals can weigh up to about 40 kilograms in weight, which is quite remarkable. And if you take a look at 40 kilograms in comparison to 70 grams, that's one of the smallest, that is the smallest tortoise, sorry, in South Africa, which would be a speckled patloper. Patloper, translated from Afrikaans, means road walker. Very tiny little tortoise in comparison to this monster that we have got in view. He's engaged in fifth gear there. Top speed. It's actually the second one we've seen since we've sat here. So it just shows that these reptiles are out in full force at the moment. And I mean, within a space of 100 meters, we found two of them. One's gone south and this one's now changed direction, going north, or directly due north. One would think that they move very slowly, and you sit and watch a tortoise, it actually moves quite quick for its bulbous body structure. And we're just enjoying some shade here that this beautiful large camel thorn is providing us while on our journey to the northwestern sections of Tswalu. So this is the period in which these reptiles will also find mates. So if you find females, they'll be laying down a pheromone trail. There's the second one, David. See it right over that trunk there? Just David's going to get us in position. It's a bit of a reach. Got him. You see the split trunk there? Of the camel thorn, just left to the split of the trunk. That split trunk camel thorn. Sorry, folks, let me just, you see the vegetation in the back? Got it, nice one, David. Beautiful, beautiful leopard tortoise as well. So it just shows you the proximity of these two. This actually might be a male and a female.
So, we've been sitting here at this watering hole for the past couple of minutes and looking at two crocodiles. This is the one. You can see right in front part of the tooth from the bottom jaw showing. And not far from where this one, the other one went under the water. Just have a look at that. You can hardly see them. You wouldn't know that they are crocs here until they come up. And they've been quite active, and I think it's because of this weather. I've seen on humid days, you do see the crocs move around a little bit more. Sometimes they're out on the bank as well. And we've stumbled upon quite a peaceful scene. But there's quite a lot going on around this watering hole. There's lots of birds around. I've seen some grey-rumped swallows flying overhead. And over there is a party of geese and one spotted hyena. It's come down for a swim. Something's just drawn its attention. I think because of all the bird movement around, and the geese making Their noise is all around. There's a lot drawing its attention. But just have a look at that. It's complete. It's got his whole body submerged. One of the little pools off to the side. Now, if I had to take a guess, I'm thinking that that little pool where the hyena is laying probably formed because of animals wallowing off to the side and a little bit of water there, and more utilizing the mud in that area than actually drinking from it. What a view. And see the Egyptian geese not bothered at all. There's a cattle egret in between as well, the western cattle egret. And looks like only one. Normally you might see them in little groups or pairs. I'm wondering, we don't often see cattle egret on Ngala. And I can't help but wonder whether that might be an indication that somewhere nearby in one of the big clearings there might be a herd of buffalo around. I find the hyena in the water quite interesting. But imagine how hot that hyena must have been in the heat of the day. It was probably laying down somewhere nearby, and as soon as the breeze picked up, decided to move over towards the water to come and cool down. And I wonder, I can see it's looking carefully across the water. It does seem quite alert, and I'm wondering if it's just taking a chance and having a look to see if there might be any other hyenas coming down or any opportunities, as they are completely, or one of the most opportunistic predators, just like the crocodile. Mrs. Ferret, good question. Does the crocodile pose a threat to the hyena? Yes, it does indeed. And I think that is also part of why this hyena is so alert. It knows that there are crocodiles in this watering hole. And even though it's reaping the benefits of a cool water puddle on the side, it knows that the crocodile can get into all of those spots, and it needs to be alert. The crocs in this particular watering hole is not very large, and I don't know if they pose a serious threat to the hyena, but in general, larger crocodiles will definitely pose a threat to the hyena, especially when it's in the water, where the croc is in its element and the hyena is outside of its normal, natural environment. But then again, if I look carefully at that hyena, it looks like the eyes are slowly closing, which means it's quite comfortable. Maybe it's just all the bird activity nearby that's making it look around like that. I have seen some herds of impalas nearby, quite large herds of impalas. There were some young ones nearby. And then also some zebra here and there on the edges of the tree line, a little bit further away from the water. back there. Here we go. There's a group of impala there. And there were some zebra there just now. They must have left. You can see the one impala staring off into the distance at the back, the male. I don't know if he's drawn towards the activity of the starlings there in the background, or whether he might have think that he saw something in and amongst the trees. And if you notice, all of those impalas have their heads down except the two at the back. Which is quite it's one of the advantages of being in a group like this. It's the one or two looking up. Is looking out for anything that might be moving, like a possible danger. Or maybe he's just seeing other impalas in and amongst the trees. There we go, there's a zebra. One zebra resting its head on the other one's back.
Welcome back to the mother, and look at what we have here. Our mission has been paid off. We have a young male cheetah. Oh, it got a rabbit, got a hare. Oh, there you go. He's on the move. Still on the move. Oh, he's super fast. Look at how he's sprinting. Got it. Ladies and gentlemen, we just happened to witness a hunt. Not a very big animal, but at least the cheetah has found something. He's got a scrap here. Wow, well done to this cheetah. Looks like a very shy cheetah, so I'm just going to keep a distance. It has never happened that fast. Just come here, see the cheetah, and then there he goes, the hunt. So my mission today was to find this cheetah. And I never knew that I'll come across one. So looking on this short grass plain, I just happened to see him perched on a termite mound. And then got here, he started moving because he looked like a little bit shy. So as he was walking, he came across that scrub here and boom, he got it. So I'm just going to drive slowly and see if we can at least get a glimpse of him. It has happened so fast. I was just positioning and boom, got it. Just going to turn around from this position. I'm not sure which cheetah this is, so I'm just going to check and position well. As I do that, let me send you over to another live location.
We've stopped in Namulwati to admire Mrs. Wahlberg. I have to say, she's positioned herself so we don't have the best view anymore. I thought I could see a chick, but it's just mom. and her bottom side. Do you think if we went forward, we would get a better view? Okay, let's try this together to go forward. I definitely saw a chick the other day during one of our silent segments. There's definitely a chick in that nest, I can assure you. And we're in the Mulwati with along with lots of other vehicles to try and see these leopards. No luck so far. But if I was a leopard, which I'm not, I would be here. Hello, Mama. How's this? This is good. But there is definitely one chick, and they normally only lay one egg. So therefore, I would imagine there's only one chick in this nest. And the pale morph is Mama of this monogamous pair, who had the most wonderful sighting with the helmeted shrikes this morning, and their chicks. It'd be so lovely just to get a glimpse. Can we please have a glimpse of your baby, Mrs. Wahlberg? There was definitely a little head that popped up the other day and it was quite dark. Normally they are quite dark grey when they're a chick. The down is grey. And then when the sort of final feathers start to emerge, they'll either be the pale morph, the dark morph, or the intermediate morph. Oh, apparently you can see the beak of a chick? No, you can't. The head. My cameraman's doing sign language to me. You're quite good at that. Okay, I can't see anything, but apparently you can see a head. I hope you can all see it. I didn't see a chick in this particular nest last year. It's the same monogamous pair, same nest. They reuse it time and time and time again. And I didn't see a chick. I had a funny feeling this pair were not successful last year. I saw it that time. No sign language needed. I saw it. I hope you all saw it too, everyone. The new generation of the Wahlbergs eagles, born and bred in Djuma. Congratulations, Mrs. Wahlberg. Now, of course, many of you know that the Wahlberg's house is very close to Sebberg's house, Olivia's house, and sadly there's still no sign of her. But they really could have moved just into thicker vegetation, so I want to stay positive and just think that they will be around somewhere, and we'll just keep checking, and hopefully one day they'll just reappear. I'm missing her dearly, and I know that many of you are too. Come on, little one, pop your head up one more time. Now, just look at the back of Mum's head. Do you see how it's almost angular? It almost looks like she's got a really pointy head at the back, the sort of crown of the head. Now, it's not, it's just the arrangement of the feathers. But if you're ever unsure if it's a Wahlberg's or not, that's a key thing to look for. Looks like she's got a very angular skull. No, that's not the case. Oh, what a wonderful sight. And I hope you all managed to see that chick there. We're going to continue our dry river cruise to see what else we can find.
Well, that eagle looks very beautiful. And it have a good look at it. Well, I have something quite different and something that we always hear us talk about, but you never really get to see it unless you've been here in our plains. What I have here is elephant wax, and this is a Wambugia ugandensis tree, or the Kenyan green heart. The bark is very pepperish and contains medicinal uses, usually very good for, you know, toothaches and also tummy aches, and also it's an antibiotic. There you can see elephants have been digging. You see those white marks? Those are elephant tusks. You see how it's been, you know, trying to debark it, and it has succeeded there. The tree, the back of the tree is so tightly to the back, to the main trunk, such that sometimes they have to try and dig in. Look there, that's very fresh, only a few days old. And that's how sometimes the elephant break their tusks, trying to debark a tree like this. And you have two long tusks, you try to dig in, and sometimes you dig too deep, and trying to pull out, you break your tusks. That's how they do it. The tree has developed a technique, and it grows these knobs that are so big, sometimes, you know, the elephant is not able to dig in.
There's a whole beautiful herd of elephants, along with some tiny babies that have just arrived at the waterhole, having the best play session ever. Surrounded by the mothers and the older females, the young ones can feel safe and play and frolic and really cool down on what is probably so far the hottest day that I've felt in the last couple of weeks. Look how the mother, look how they all bunch together like that as they move forward. Now they're having a bit of a drink. Do you see that? They're moving forward and just drinking the water gently, trying to get away from the place where they were all mud wallowing. The babies all amongst there, safe among the feet of the parents. Oh, that's amazing. There's a whole bunch of young bulls that are also there that were playing before, which I'm sure they'll have to be a bit wary of. They don't want to cause any trouble with the parents. Those young bulls get too involved in the amongst the young ones. Wow, actually heading straight across the water, which is quite unusual. Normally they go for a mud wallow on the right hand side there. Oh, chasing off the impala, no time for you. Oh no way, look at the little baby that's fallen face first into the water. Oh, that was exactly the spot where the older female fell. I think it was yesterday. She had a bit of a tantrum and went face first into the water. Gosh, that's funny. Oh, that one little one's also doing it. I'm pretty sure he just did the splits. I'm not sure how comfortable that is for an elephant. Oh, it's got no tail. Oh, we've seen this little one before. It's a little one with no tail. Look at that. So I wonder what happened to this little elephant. Could easily have been caused by a predator when it was very young. Or maybe hooked in a tree or a branch as it was running. Something must have happened to it, but it's got no tail. Oh, it looks so cute. Doing a fast walk, catching up with mum as she heads off into the bushes. So you can see she's lactating heavily. So these both potentially belonging to her. Well, actually, no, it's unusual. It would be unlikely for them both at the same similar age to belong to her. Ah, it looks like they've stopped there. They're probably going to have a dust bathe. I would not be surprised if we start seeing huge plumes of dust appearing there. That's a very dusty patch. See how all the young bulls just trail behind there? They're on the edge. They're on the periphery. They're close to being kicked out of the herd. You know, they might still be associating with them, but if they get too rowdy with the youngsters, they will be chased away by the parents. Just love that. We didn't hear anything apart from the trumpeting and whatever, which just sounds like playful stuff, but there must also have been some, you know, communication that happened between the matriarch. You see that one there is not very muddy. There's one that's quite dry. That might be the matriarch. She might have just been standing aside, just watching, not getting too involved so she doesn't distract herself too much. She probably just said to them all, okay, swim time's over, let's keep moving. And so they did. One elephant's just having a good scratch against the apple leaf there, scratching his bum when no one was looking. Sometimes when you've got an itch, you just have to scratch. So we talked about some of the large trees here on Pride Lands and how they have been growing much longer than they would normally. And you can see there how the trees just dwarf the elephants in some places. They really are spectacularly large. None of these are massive bull elephants, but they're sizable creatures. A good few meters tall, so you can see those trees are exceptionally large. I'm going to stop there in the shade amongst those trees, probably feed on some of the grass that's sheltered, some of the bushes and shrubs. I'm sure they won't go too far, because it is very, very hot today, and it's going to stay hot until well after sun. They'll travel too far. They'll probably be back again at some time this evening to have another swim before bedtime.
This crocodile has just caught a very large fish. Not exactly sure what fish, and it's currently in its jaws. Now it's just stopped momentarily. But I'm hoping that we might get to see it flick the fish around and maybe throw its head from side to side. But I think it's used quite a bit of energy, so it's probably just taking a quick breather. Here we go, you can see the fin of the fish. I wonder if the fish is still alive, it doesn't look like it. In fact, it does look like the fin is moving up and down, so maybe the fish was still alive. Maybe that side-to-side movement was to finally kill it. If I had to take a guess, I'd say, judging from the size and the size of the crocodile from where I'm sitting, it's likely that it's a sharp-toothed catfish. And they are very, very resilient, and often too large to just swallow in one go. You see the fin raising itself up. Awesome stuff. That is a massive fish. Don't let it go, don't let it go. Well, I think most of it's done. What a huge fish. It was definitely, it looks like the fish is still alive. And what's happening now? I'm sure the croc's got the situation under control. It is unusual to see it leave such a hard-earned meal. That is absolutely amazing when you knew it. I wanted to say there's no way that croc would have let that situation slip away. You can hear a blacksmith lapwing going crazy there next to the crocodile. Now in the distance, the other crocodile is also making its way over towards this one with the fish. And it should be interesting to see what the situation is once that one comes near. One of the interesting things about crocodiles that we don't always think about is that they actually do have a quite a complex social hierarchy. And even though there might only be two regular crocodiles at this watering hole, there's definitely a hierarchy. And we might see a bit of that dynamic once that one comes close. Look at the crocodile on the right lifting its back or the part of its tail out of the water. My guess is to That's kind of like a warning to the other croc. That is incredible. It literally went under the tail of that croc. And that croc actually looks bigger now that it's closer. This is super, super fascinating. I've actually never seen this behavior before.
So we actually found those cheetahs a little bit earlier that we were looking for, but the weather was threatening a bit, so we had to go a little bit closer to the lodges. But we actually found this blue wildebeest bull by himself. He almost said buffalo bull. I was thinking it looks a lot like a buffalo. But it was quite interesting. There was a single Ngala bull that was feeding around with it as well, and the two bulls obviously was enjoying each other's company. With an extra pair of eyes, both of them were happy to have the other one around. But this blue wildebeest bull is really enjoying this nice green grass after we had a bit of rain about a week ago, and it's nice and short around here, so you can see around him all the time. Not a lot of long grass for four lions to hide away in. He hasn't even really picked his head up at all. You can see the grass and stuff moving behind him and so on as the wind picks up. Oh, he's just picked his head up there and listening to behind us here. Bit of a lick there into his nostril as well. That may be something getting stuck there. So scratching his face against his foot there. And this is a dominant bull, so unlike in the Masai Mara where the blue wildebeest will migrate long distances after the grazing, here in this section of southern Africa where Phinda is, the grass is pretty green and there's grazing almost all year long. So this bull is a territorial bull and he'll stay in this area for as long as he possibly can throughout his life to keep it, because it is actually a small watering hole close by. So in the breeding season, when the females come through this area, he knows they need to come to the water, and he's got this good short grazing around here, and he'll fight other bulls that is around for these little patches of territory. He's not really too phased about the wind, but you can see he just picks his head up every now and then to have a look around him. So he'll feed for a couple of minutes or so with his head down and see how he just scans quickly in a few directions. Maybe the grass moving is just catching his attention as well. And there his head goes down again. Quite a big bull, and you can see this is a bull just by looking at the size of his horns, so the thickness of it. If you look, they are just protruding a little bit past his ears there, so that tells us it's a bull. And you can also see below his stomach the little penile sheath that he's got there. With the females, often the horns are just about the same length as the ears, or a little bit shorter than the ears. But for now, I think Craig and I are going to keep on driving around on these open clearings here and see if we can maybe track down some other animals.
Well, I decided to stay here because I wasn't done with this tree. Remember, it's called the Kenyan Green Hat, or the Wembagia ugandensis. This is a tree that, apart from elephants using it as medicinal for their tummies, we humans use it also for toothbrush. I've walked around here trying to find a stick small enough so I could show you the toothbrush and how we make it, but I couldn't find. But I will be showing you that tomorrow. I'll try and bring one from camp. But what I got, it's a fruit. And the fruit is very small and round, looks like small avocado. The taste is very bitter, sweet sour. When it's ripe, it's very much like avocado, very sweet, but it's sour. And this is how it looks. The smell is like menthol, really a beautiful smell. And when using the toothbrush from this tree, usually the pepper gets into your mouth and it kills all the bacteria. So I believe it's a toothbrush that is very rare, nobody has discovered, and it comes with toothpaste to kill the bacteria. And that's why the Maasai and many people have got beautiful, you know, white teeth over here. These ones here, you can tell the baboons have been trying to chew on them, but they were still not ripe, and so they left them. This is what they look like. The pepper tree, or the Kenyan green heart, it is called Wambugia ugandensis. So it's a tree used by animals, used by us for many, many uses. And I'll leave it, but I promise to bring a toothbrush tomorrow so that I can show you how it's made, and maybe the reaction from the pepper in it will tell you how I feel. Yes, that was the tree itself. Grows to be around 60 feet tall, and it's a softwood, so it's not good for you know, wood in any way, but it grows to be almost 60-70 years, then dries up and falls. By the way, that was the warden, the guy in charge of making sure our rhinos are safe. They're always and constantly securing them and doing patrols. The temperature has dropped now, and I'm gonna drive towards my lions and see if they're still lying on or they're becoming lions. They're going out to find something. This area usually is full of elephants, but I haven't seen any. I think it's because there is food everywhere and they have left this area to recuperate so they can come for it later. Okay, let's take you to another live location.
Welcome back. We are almost entering this beautiful undulating landscape, whereas you can see the scene in front of us. That is a beautiful, the dominance of that terminalia or silver cluster leaf, and you can see how many there are. That actually creates like a little mini forest of like this luminescent green. And so this straight road takes us into the southern part of that area, and then what we're going to do is bend directly due west and end up on those dunes on the far left hand side that David will show you in a couple of minutes. We're going to stop inside there, we're going to scratch around, we're going to see what insects we can find. It doesn't seem like this part of the reserve has received a lot of rain in comparison to the south and southeastern parts of Tswalu. You can still see it's a little bit drier out to the north, northwestern sections over here. But we nonetheless are going to scratch around for any insects that we can unearth. It's always a treat to look at and understand the diversity of these tiny little critters. And then we're going to look for larger mammals once the cooler part of the afternoon approaches. And hopefully we can come right with maybe a cheetah out here. It's a really good area for cheetah. There's a lot of wild cheetah on Tswalu. And if we do have a sighting, it'll be from a distance. But these dunes provide a perfect platform to us for us to survey and obviously scan the landscape for any presence of carnivores. It's a very beautiful area. So we're going to venture up there soon and hopefully we can unearth some amazing animals.
Welcome back to our lone cheetah who has finished the snack, cheetah snack. That was a small meal. At least it has given him energy. Oh, that's a nice rollover. Shows a little bit of excitement. At least now he has a bit of energy, so he might hunt tomorrow because it seems like it's almost getting dark. So cheetahs will always be diurnal, so hunting during the day and just before it gets dark. Even though cheetahs hunt during the night, at night they can also hunt. When there's full moon, they can be walking around and finding something to eat. Male cheetahs are known to be active at night sometime, walking from one area to another. But female cheetahs will always pick a spot where they'll rest the entire night. They're on the bottom list of the food chain, so we find that they can fall prey to lion, leopard, and even hyena. So whenever they come across a meal, they have to eat as much as they can to make sure that kleptoparasitism, where predators will snatch or take over other predators' food, will not happen. Seems like a young cheetah, so I'd say maybe this year it got dispersed with the mother. So we find that only males will form a coalition, but then most of the time they're always solitary. So if he had a sibling who is a male, then they would have been together. So they always make that bond forever. But nevertheless, out here, if he comes across another young cheetah of the same age, they can form up a team. See the beautiful Ipomia flowering, or the morning glory flowering. So this time of the year, during the rains, we have lots of flowering plants. We have the tissue paper flowers, which are just close to the cheetah. I'm so much excited because I haven't seen a cheetah for almost a month, and then coming across this cheetah and then makes a hunt makes it even more blissful. Jack, where do other animals go at nighttime? So always, herbivores pick a spot where they can spend the entire night. And this particular spot is somewhere where it's safe enough, where they can watch over for predators, a place where there's short grass, and a place where at least it's raised, where they can have a 360-degree angle watch out. If it's elephants, elephants sometimes walk into the forest. And if it's a cheetah like this, he might pick a spot out in the open like that and then spend the rest of the night, or maybe just close to the bush. The snack that he just had has given him energy, so he's actually looking for something else. You can tell that hair was not enough for him, so he's scanning for more. Problem is, there's lots of grass here, tall grass, so it makes it even hard for him to pursue prey, so he has to walk, find prey. Doesn't get lucky right now, in the fall of dark, that is where he'll pick up the spot to actually spend the entire night. You can see the mane on his back, and that tells you that he's still a young cheetah. A little bit shy. So the advantage that he has is the grass is tall and he blends in so well, so at least he can get closer to whatever he's eyeing on, if it's impala, Thompson gazelle. So they always go for smaller prey, maybe baby topi. So that is what he'll be looking for right now. So we have our other people who've come to enjoy this sighting. So I'll just carry on to position a better angle. He's picked a nice spot to rest, just on the patch of the tissue paper flowers. You can see lots of white flowers, that's called the tissue paper flowers. Look at how it blends in well. Looks like a stylish cheetah because he's picked a nice flower area to rest. So, because he just had a small meal, that scrub here, so he needs to walk out from that particular spot because it's almost night. and hyenas will start to be active, even leopards. So whenever there's a kill, hyenas, remember, can be able to smell a kill or a carcass 4 kilometers away downwind. And if they happen to smell that particular spot where he had that meal, they might be attracted and come there. And in the end, this cheetah can fall victim, can fall prey. So he needs to walk out of that scene, and that's the sole reason he's just moved to that particular spot. You can see he's cleaning himself. Most cats, after eating, they'll always clean their faces. A little facial rubbing, applying saliva on their front paws and then rubbing onto their faces. There you go, he's doing the cleaning again. Do cheetahs eat every part of the scrub here? Scrub here have small and soft bone tissues. So I'm sure the only part that they don't eat is the fluffy coat, fluffy outer coating. So that is the only place that they might avoid. And sometimes when they're feeding, you see them plucking off the hair or the fur. But then almost the entire carcass is consumed. But only leaving the intestine, because hares are vegetarian, they eat plant matter, they're herbivores. So you find that the intestine part, which has plant matter, will be avoided. So the rest will be eaten, and also avoiding the fur. Happy. You can see how he's rolling over. So he has to be on the lookout. You can see how his ears are spread out, listening all angles, because he doesn't want to come across hyenas or even lions and leopard. They also pick places where least expected to find them, and that's how they also avoid predators. So there's no game here, it's actually quiet. So lions, hyenas, and even leopard will not come in search of prey around here. So we find most predators will move or walk around following prey. So this particular spot, or within this radius, we don't have wildlife. So we don't have impala, we don't have topi around. So it's a safe spot to actually spend the night. I think he's seen something. I'm going to hang around this with this cheetah to see what else he'll go and find. Maybe if he might make a kill before the end of the show. So taking you over to another live location.
We are back on Torchwood with Miss Tandy. And we have just had the most remarkable sights. I'm going to try and show you it a little bit later. Of about 9 battleiers and tawny eagles all sitting together under one tree. Got male battleiers, female battleiers, lots of juveniles, all different ages, and a group of tawnies all sitting together. It was remarkable. We'll go back around and show you in just a moment, but we thought let's come and join Miss Tandy, who clearly did not catch anything after we left her this morning. And she's on top of the termite mound, which is probably helping keep her cool and in the shade, panting heavily. I I don't think she's particularly watching anything. But I imagine when it gets cooler after her unsuccessful attempt this morning, she'll try and hunt again tonight. Tandy really has taken up residence on Torchwood. I think she spends probably about 80% of her time on Torchwood and probably about 20% of her time on Djuma. That's obviously just a guesstimate, but she's sighted on Torchwood every day now. And of course we can traverse here, which is just wonderful. I haven't heard news where her cub is, her son, but I'm hoping they might meet, hoping they'll reunite. He's not even 9 months old yet, so he still will spend a lot of time with Mum. But once we can reposition a little bit, we'll get a little bit closer to her and we'll try and show you all these battleiers in the background. Actually, she doesn't look like she's positioned herself very well in the shade. That's why you're hot, dear. That expression says it all. I can't think who the male and female tracks belong to in the Mulwati. It's not known. Hukamuri's back in the west. Mulwati was actually found down south. And therefore, the only real male that sort of moves that we know of in Djuma could be Tangana. Was he following a lady? We do not know. It can't be Tandy. She's here. Is he following Klalamba? Does he want a free meal or something else? But unfortunately, no vehicles got lucky. Tandy's son does not have a name yet. We normally wait till 1 year. And as I just mentioned, he's not even 9 months. It's a sort of ongoing policy here that we wait till 1 year to name the leopards. They don't have a high survival rate. And of course, naming does mean attachment. So he's still just Tandy's Mippin Pan at the moment, which is small one, little one in Shanghai. It'll be the stakeholders in the area, mostly Djuma. I believe that will be very much involved in choosing the right name for Tandy's son. So we've still got a little bit of time to wait until the naming process begins. Magic Dragon, is that you? Magic Dragon Wizard. If it is, we have not heard from you in a long time, and it's lovely to hear your name. I have no idea. That is just too speculative. I am sorry. I think when it goes to Tandy, I remember when I first joined 2 years ago. People were saying Tandy will not have any more litters, and then, of course, she went on to have two. She did, unfortunately, lose the two cubs that we found her with. They didn't make it. And again, she's gone on to have another litter. And now we have a very, very strong, healthy little boy. So I think Tandy will not stop being able to reproduce until she reaches the end of her life, I'm afraid. And some people do use the term losing condition, and it's actually not the correct term to use when you apply that to a leopard. Yes, they'll get older, they'll get a bit grumpy, get a bit tattered around the ears and the face, but they're not losing condition. If a leopard was to lose condition, it wouldn't last long out here. It would just peacefully slip away into the night and probably never be found. So both Tandy and the likes of Tangana are thriving. They're really fit. Yes, they're older, but they're extremely fit and healthy. So I have no idea how many more litters Tandy may have. She could go to 16 years old, she could go older. She knows this environment. She's navigated this landscape for 14 years. She's surrounded by offspring. She knows who her enemies are. Still territorial. I really don't know. I did see a herd of impala behind us, so I wonder when it just gets a little bit cooler if she'll start to think, that's exactly what I want to go for. Here we go. I didn't think she was going to stay stationary for too long. But we are in a sighting with other vehicles, so we'll let them move first, and then we will follow her. I think she's spotted something. Just let these other vehicles move, I'm afraid. There's not much we can do. And then once we're able to catch up with her, we will, and we're going to go and show you guys all those battle ears.
So we've left that watering hole and we're heading back towards the central part of the reserve, as well as the Thimbavati riverbed side. And along the way, we suddenly had a whiff, a really strong whiff of chocolate or cacao. And we weren't sure what it is, so we had a stop, looked at all the little plants and trees nearby, smelled most of the flowers, and we didn't come across anything that had that strong chocolate odor. And what I'm assuming it might be is there were also some ants on the ground. And it might be that some of those ants released that odor, but I'm really not too sure, and it's something that I think I'm gonna go have a deeper look into tonight. But currently it's warmed up quite a bit. The huge clouds and the buildup of that storm we saw earlier seems like it's moved past Ngala and completely away, which means that now the sun's out in full force. And it's really, really hot here. But as we get down towards the valley of the Thimbavati riverbed, we're hoping that once we get there, it'll be a little bit cooler in the shade of the tall trees along the banks of the Thimbavati.
And hopefully we might get to see a little bit more life that side. The area that we're driving through is an area with large open spaces. And that's where we're looking.
Oh, we are just repositioning. Bear with us. We're going to have to take our time repositioning here. I think we're going to have to go all the way around to the other side, I'm afraid. She's not in the best spot. But maybe what we can do is show you all these bataleers. It's so unbelievable. Look at them all. You're going to see them in just a moment. Can you get them from here? I was going to try and go a little bit closer. How's that? Okay, hopefully you'll be able to see. I'm obviously going to get my binos out as well. But we have female bataleer, male bataleer, one juvenile now, two tonies sitting next to the juvenile and the bataleers, side by side, all having a really jolly good time. And another bird just landed, but I can't quite identify it. It's gone behind the branch. Isn't this lovely? I've never seen anything like it, really. So it's the male sitting with the juvenile. The female's got that additional barring at the other side. I think it's another tawny that joined. Yes, it is. All different color morphs. All three of the tawnies are completely different color morphs. Oh, there you go. That's the color of that one. I just think this is so remarkable. I really have never seen this before. Normally you see bataleers in a tree. Yes, you see tonies in a tree. But everybody together, the male, the female, the juveniles. That's the female there on the left. You can see by that additional sort of bar. This is so lovely. And if we just go back to the other side, on the right-hand side, what's so ideal here is that the juvenile bataleer is right in front of the male. Now, when the male decides to turn his head, you'll see how remarkably different they are. They are not similar at all. And it's the same species, most likely the offspring of this male and female. You see, it doesn't look anything like the adult. You see that? I mean, of course, there's similarities, but in terms of colouring and plumage, it's completely different. And then look at the tawny on the other side. Obviously very hot. What a really, really lovely sighting. Sometimes when the offspring, the juvenile bataleer, tries to join the adults, they just fly off. It's so nice to see them sort of perched on a tree together. And you'll be able to see the juvenile tail feathers are so much longer in the bataleer than the adult. They really don't look anything alike. Can we just go to that one that flew? I wonder if, is that a steppe eagle? It looks a lot larger. And if you look at those legs, you see how baggy they are? It almost looks like he's wearing those baggy sweatpants that people wear in the house when you don't really want to see anybody else. And then you get very attached to him. I think this is a steppe. It's very difficult to see the eye and the gape from here, but the tawny feathers on the legs are not this baggy. They're normally tapered. They start off thick and then they go down to a point. Wow, if I'm correct, that's three different species all chilling together, getting ready for sundowners. Yeah. Yes, I think this is a step. So you just had a really close look at this one, but if we go back to the tawny on the right, you'll see the feathers on the legs are completely different. It's a true eagle, so the feathers go all the way down, but you'll see they're not baggy. That's actually not the best views, but you see they're not sort of really, really thick, as if it's wearing sweatpants. Just three different species on this tree here. FC, can I just check you're still with us? R. Lara Moore, you're saying you're surprised to see... My comms are breaking up. I think we're in a little bit of a tricky spot in Torchwood. But you're surprised to see something. Mel, can you just repeat that comment from R. Lara Moore? You are surprised to see two juveniles. There was definitely two juveniles when I first arrived, but I can't see where the second juvenile has flown off to. But yes, I was surprised too. Two juveniles, just the sheer sort of mixture of species here. I'm looking through my binos, but I can't see where the second juvenile flew off to, but there definitely was one when we first arrived, two juvenile battleiers. Wow. Now, although Tony and Step are very similar, they're completely different in size as well. Have you just found the second juvenile? I'm not sure if that is the second juvenile or not.
The family tree.
Somebody's just flew off. I wonder if they're all start to fly off at the same time. The female battleier seems to not be enjoying socializing so much, but the male is having a great time. Maybe that tawny's a female. You know, birds, when they're said to be monogamous, 90% of birds are said to be monogamous. And yet, it's really not often true. Storybooks, you're saying it's a raptor family tree. Yes, it's a raptor family tree. Literally. How long did it take you to think that one up? Kurt, did you think that one up? He's king of one-liners, this one. Yes, it's a raptor family tree. Isn't it just remarkable, though? What a lovely, lovely sighting. I do think we will need to go back to Tandy, though, because we're taking space up in that sighting. As you know, there's only three vehicles allowed. So we need to go back, see her, before someone else wants to come in. But that was just really wonderful. Okay, let's see if we can position. Okay, so hopefully we can get into a much better position to view our queen.
A lonely elephant bull has arrived to enjoy a thoughtful moment of solitude here at Ngala Dam, away from the crowds, away from all the noise of the other elephants, not the spurfowl. Of course, they are rampantly making lots of noise. Just enjoying the peace as the sun starts to dip. It's just dipping close to the horizon. We can feel the temperature starting to change. Not changed yet. It's still very warm, but it's starting to dip. Oh, scratching his ear there. Just wondering what to do next. We often scratch our heads when we're trying to think. I do wonder what elephants think about. Like, is this elephant thinking about what to do next? Or is it purely going on instinct? When it's hungry, it eats. When it's thirsty, it drinks. I wonder, does an elephant have a sense of self? I think we discussed this before. I think elephants do have a sense of self. They can recognize themselves in mirrors. The elephant's not the only thing at the waterhole. There are some other birds around. There's the geese, of course, as always, the blacksmith lapwing, the red-billed buffalo weavers who live here. The elephants always take that pathway there, and it always surprises me because there's lots of roots there. They often trip over the roots and things. I suppose it's shallow and the ground is harder. It's not so much like clay. The question is, are you going to take the hard road? Yes, it looks like you are. This is a very tall elephant. Strangely long legs, I feel. Doesn't make it easy to climb when your body is so heavy and your legs are so long. You can do it. Come on, push. Oh, man, I always have to, like, hold my breath when elephants climb up steep embankments like that. I just feel like I need to help give them a little mental push. See, it's swinging its leg there, the silhouette. It's making a decision, and it's going to go down the other side. Picking up speed as it goes. And gone. Amazing to watch the animals come and go. So we've sat at Ngala Dam basically the whole afternoon, and we've seen a buffalo herd early on moving away. We've had lots of elephants come down. Of course, all the birds coming and going. Lots of birds courting, actually. Laughing doves with the males. You can see them puffing out their chests and bobbing their heads, trying to entice the females. It didn't look like they were really falling for it, though. But it's just so lovely. Really enjoyed it. Especially with the heat that we had earlier today. Just to sit and feel the breeze off the water. Not a particularly fragrant breeze, I will say. But at least a bit cooler. Not too much wind, though. Very still. That's mostly ripples from that elephant bull as he left the water. I'm sure in the next 5 minutes that'll become as still as a piece of glass.
So we finally managed to reposition. Tandy doesn't make it easy for you. But then we know that. It's starting to get marginally cooler. I'm starting to feel a little bit relief. A little bit of cloud coverage. So I can imagine she's starting to feel it too. The intense heat just exhausts everyone. I think we're all going to have an early bed tonight. What about you, Tandy? Are you going to have an early bed? I don't think so. Creatures of the night. And that's one of the main reasons that they are nocturnal, because obviously it's not this hot and humid in winter. But in summer, it's almost unbearable. And although they absolutely can hunt during the day, it's going to be exhausting. And they're going to sort of spend far more energy hunting during the day than they would do when it's cooler. They're going to really dig into that energy budget of theirs. It's all economic survival out here when it comes to energy. And same with us. Sometimes humans feel completely depleted. We've exhausted ourselves. We've burnt the candle at both ends. And we think, oh, I just need to lock myself away and recuperate because we've completely fizzed out. We're out of energy. Or maybe you haven't ate well that day, or you've skipped a few meals. It's very similar. Hello, beautiful. So many of you ask about the father of Tandy's cub, and it's completely unknown. We do send scat away for analysis, DNA analysis, by an organization called Panthera. We do scoop up scat. It's a delightful task. We ship it off and it gets analyzed. And of course, the DNA that they do have, they can match it up. Or even if they can't match it, they can at least eliminate the process of elimination. And it's really unknown. I firmly think it's definitely not Tingana's. One, for many reasons, I don't think he looks anything like Tingana, but that's, of course, my perception. Every human perceives things differently. But also the movements of Tingana and Tandy now. Tingana going very nomadic. I really, really do feel he's not Tingana. So the two main options are quarantine and Mulwati. I know some people that think quarantine, I know some people that think Mulwati. I guess we won't actually know until we're able to analyse the wonderful smelly scat that comes from her son. And just like Kosana, the future for her son, once he gets to around 2 years old, give or take, that's the sort of benchmark for a male leopard. Could be earlier, could be later. There's always a benchmark. Once he gets to about 2 years old, he'll disperse. Just like Kosana did. He'll go and find new stomping grounds, set up his own territory, and find some ladies that are not relatives. It's very important for a species to, for the males or the females sometimes to disperse in order to maintain genetic integrity. Leopards can inbreed for about 3 generations, but still it's not a good thing. Even though they can do it, it's not a positive thing for the species. They need to maintain the genetic integrity and not mate with relatives. At least if you think about an area like the Sabi Sands where we are, the larger area of the Sabi Sands is fenced for many reasons, to protect predators from, well, going into civilizations, I guess. But it's a huge area. There's lots of room for movement. The animals can then move into the Kruger. And this allows for males to disperse and females to move extraterritorially for mating purposes. Whereas if you compare that to, let's just say, the Ethiopian wolf, whose populations are so low, under 500, and they're constricted and confined to a very small habitat. They're too specialized and there's nowhere else to go. They're up the mountain at about 4,000 meters. There's nowhere else to go. The numbers are continuing to reduce and there's no fresh numbers coming in, and therefore the genetic integrity is completely compromised. They've started mating with domestic dogs as well, which is possible, so they're hybridizing, and that's further completely ruining the genetic integrity of the species. Where at least here in the Sabi Sands, these animals can move, individuals can move. Tandy has the opportunity to mate with many different males, which she needs to do, and the males, of course, have the opportunity to mate with many different females, which they need to do. They both do it for completely different reasons, though. But they are promiscuous by nature. And it's important for both sexes, male and female, to mate with multiple individuals. Why? Well, for males, you're just sowing your wild seeds, I guess, and producing as many offspring as you can that will have your DNA. You're ensuring that your bloodline is thorough and complete by mating with many different females. All the offspring in the area could be yours, no other males. Whereas for females, they mate with many different males to confuse paternity. So let's just say, for example, Tandy mates with Tingana, Mulwati, and Quarantine. 3 handsome, striking males. Every single one of those males will know that they have mated with Tandy, and she sort of roams within their territory, give or take. They will assume that the offspring Tandy has is theirs, and therefore they will not be inclined to kill the offspring, which male leopards do. They come across a female with unknown offspring that they haven't mated with, they will kill the offspring immediately, because it's not theirs. Why let a female have offspring in your territory when it's not yours? Why would you allow that? You wouldn't. So females are very clever, and they're trying to make all the males think this is yours. It's a very, very smart way to survive out here, and it's all about the survival of her offspring. She just wants to ensure the safety of her cubs, to ensure that no male comes in and kills them. Vane, I think that name was. You're asking, why are leopards so difficult to find? Well, they're not, really. Not here. They're very, very easy to track and find here in the Sabi Sands. Now, it's summer, so it's a lot trickier. The bush is so, so thick. We probably drive past lots of animals on a daily basis, and you just can't see. There's lots of tracking skills that you can follow. You listen, you use your sense of smell, you look for signs. If they've got a kill, maybe vultures are in the area. And we also know their territories. I was actually saying this morning that they're creatures of habit. They will frequent the same water holes. They will use the same roads, especially territorial adults. So out here, it's surprisingly easy and they're very habituated. But I do know that in other parts of the world, it's very, very rare to spend so much time with leopards. They're shy by nature because they're solitary and elusive. But out here, they're really easy to find. Now, I say that, I'm probably not going to find one for the next week. But in comparison to other parts of the world, they are easy to find. Christina, they do have incredibly long tails, don't they? It does look as long as her body. I think it's almost the same length that reaches to their neck. Slightly bulbous at the end. Nowhere near as bulbous as a cheetah's. They use theirs as a rudder. But it's remarkably long. I don't think it quite, if they folded it over, I don't think it quite reaches the end of their nose. But it does cover most of the body. So elegant. Really, really hoping her cub bounds along and joins her. Tandy's maternal instincts are fierce. Okay, we're going to sit as long as we can at this sighting with Tandy.
As you can see here, lots of movement in the shallows of Ndlovu Dam. Lots of terrapins are on the move. See, trying to catch insects. It's now late in the evening and it's still incredibly humid. And this is the perfect, perfect weather for insects. Not a breath of wind, as you can see, apart from the ripples that these terrapins are making. The water is completely still. And so all these insects are fluttering about, mating, landing on the water to drink. Them are laying their eggs there. And the terrapins are just going along and snapping them all up. Do you see that? Every now and again it just snaps it up. So terrapins are carnivorous, which sets them aside from tortoises and turtles that live in the ocean and tortoises that live on land. Terrapins are carnivorous, so they eat insects, but they'll also eat fish if they can catch them. So what does birds, interestingly enough? They also catch birds quite often, doves and things that come down to the water's edge. Now, these ones are very small, so I don't think they'll be catching any doves, but they're certainly eating all the insects that they can find. And you can see a lot of insects flying around, in fact, and even landing on the surface of the water. I think it's going to be a lot of mosquitoes tonight. But they also say this, I don't know if it really happens. I suppose the pressure in the air is very high, the barometric pressure right now. So perhaps it forces all the insects to come a lot lower. They can't be, so I mean, I'm not really sure how weather patterns work in great detail. But I know certainly they say when there's rain on its way, you often see birds flying low down. That's often a sign that rain is coming.
The mic forked out last time.
I'll be listening to you.
Welcome back to Tswalu. Welcome back. We are journeying very slowly through this wonderful and very diverse landscape. And we are slowly meandering through this very... David obviously can just give you a nice overview of how spectacular this section of Tswalu really is. And the angle of the sun at the moment is just allowing these trees to beam with light. They do have tiny little hairs on them, coating these leaves, and that does give it a more silvery appearance, hence the name silver cluster leaf. But a remarkable spot, and we are looking for any tracks or any signs of animals while we're slowly moving through this area. It's a bit quiet for birds. We've been looking at a tree or two, also fairly quiet with insects. But we're going to keep on going further west over here, and then we're going to end up on that big dune, and we're going to do a little bit of a scan and see what we can find. But a remarkable scene to be in and amongst. So nobody's crossed this side. A lot of oryx tracks, a lot of eland have come through here. A big herd of eland. This herd is about 150 strong through this section of Tswalu. But all in all, sometimes you just need to stop and appreciate these simple things, because it is really and truly breathtaking to be in and amongst these magnificent trees. And typically they like dune crests. Also found with Tswalu, they love dune crests. They dominate sections of dunes. And then you can also find them in drainage lines. That's where they like to be. So they typically occur here in the northern part of South Africa, and then you find them in patches going through into Botswana, which is not far from us, only about 80 kilometers. We have one of the border posts positioned off of Tswalu's location. All the leaves dancing in the wind. But we're gonna continue a little bit more west, and we're gonna end up on that lovely viewpoint, and hopefully we can spot an animal or two from up there. So let's just back up over here. We've been looking for cheetah tracks. There's a few cheetah that do like to hang out in this area. They are sub-adult, so they're a little bit skittish. Some of these animals hardly ever get to see a vehicle, so they just remain absolutely wild. They see or hear the vehicle, they are gone. We basically call them ghosts, because that is what you are chasing sometimes. But patience is key, and this is the part where animals do like to become a little bit more active. We do have a fairly cool day today. It's not a very warm day. It's a nice cool breeze coming from the southwest, and it's just keeping myself and David nice and cool. All right, well, we're gonna send you for now off to one of our colleagues, and we'll see you when you get back.
Good luck with your tracking, cheetah Kyle. I didn't need to track this cat. She was perfectly placed, almost where she was this morning. She hasn't moved very far. Now, going back to sort of economics and energetics, I guess is a better word than economics, and it's a currency for survival for any species in the animal kingdom, be it a tiny little nudibranch to a octopus, to a snake, to a leopard. Energetics is really, really important. And the animals got to balance the calories, if you like, that they consume with the calories that they're spending. I'm sure we all know about counting calories. It's not fun. But of course, they don't do it consciously. They just need to make sure they have enough and always run at a surplus, especially if they want to reproduce. It's very, very important for Tandy. And when a mother and son travel together, there was an interesting study that actually said the cub spends about 12% more energy than mom traveling the same distance. So let's just say Tandy and her son are traveling along Cheetah Cut Line. The son's going to use up 12% more on top of what is spent than Tandy's spending, because the smaller is taking a lot more energy to keep up with mom, taking bigger leaps and bigger strides. And the study also says a female who has any offspring about 1 year old, that takes up an additional 8% of your calories. So based on what they're doing, obviously it will eat into the energy budget at different rates. And this drives their influence to kill. So that's what it really means to be a predator. You've not got enough energy, you're not going to be able to sort of make these successful hunts, or at least attempt to make the successful hunts. On territorial patrol, male leopards, because they do far sort of a lot of patrols, a lot of advertising, especially when there's a high density of males around, it constitutes 25% of their daily calorie intake. That's a quarter that's used up on just being on patrol. When we see Tangana walking and scent marking and calling and scraping and being extremely territorial, that's taking up a quarter of his daily energy budget. That's why they sleep a lot too. That's why leopards generally snack a lot, and I use snack very loosely, but you'll find them eating squirrels or mongoose or scrub hares just to sustain them, to keep their energy budget high in order to have enough calories to then make a proper kill and a much bigger prey, which is going to feed you for days. You'll see Tandy do that a lot. I've been with her when she's murdered squirrels and mongoose and all sorts. Melinda, yes, the movement of the tail can sort of act in a form of communication, not necessarily overall mood, but normally when it's just flat like this, she's just relaxing. But when Tandy is walking through the thicket, and she's not trying to hide, she's just going on a journey from A to B, like we all do, going shopping, she'll raise her tail, and sort of the white flag effect for the underside, which is white, will be raised. And she's trying to say to everyone, calm down, Franklin's, no need to go crazy, and Paula, no need to go crazy, I am just here, I'm trying to get from point A to point B. No need to worry, I mean no harm, when in fact, I'm sure she would mean harm. But normally they do that when they're trying to communicate that they're not going to kill another animal. When it twitches back and forth, that's often, especially if you're close by, that can show that they're extremely irritated and they're not happy. And if it's with your presence, then that's normally a sign it's time to leave. The tail's curled up and it's twitching, twitching, twitching. Leave. The leopard's not happy with your presence. but she'll also twitch when she's hunting and she's concentrating. So yes, you must pay attention to her tail for sure. She also uses it at a fly swatter. Let's not forget that. Kaya is hot. It was 41 degrees Celsius today, 105 degrees Fahrenheit. We all suffered. I actually had to make an emergency stop back at camp for extra water. It's hot. Panting is just breathing. Domestic dogs do it, domestic cats do it. It's just a automatic biological function that we all do to survive. But she starts to pant heavily when she's hot. So she's trying to draw heat away from her body through evaporative cooling, which is exactly the same as us sweating. So when we sweat, what's happening is the surface of our skin is becoming moist with sweat droplets from the glands. And when the water droplets start to evaporate, it actually draws heat away from the body, and sweat is extremely effective and efficient. But Tandy can't do that. So she'll seek shade, but she'll also pant, and it's just breathing, but rapidly, and she's trying to pump air in and out of her mouth, which is very moist. She'll have a lot of saliva there, and the evaporation will draw heat away from her body. And that's why we always see them panting. It's summer here in the low felt. It is hot. She's cooling down now. I can tell by her sort of behavior here. She's cooling down like the rest of us. They'll also pant when they're exhausted. So if they've just made a really difficult kill and they're tired, they'll also pant, just like us going for a jog. We get hot. Our muscles are working, pumping blood around the body. We're sweating, even in winter or summer. So they'll also pant excessively then. She's scanning them. It's a perfect vantage point to be higher up. See what's around you. She's laying flat, so other animals may not necessarily spot her. That's why you often find leopards on termite mounds. And here we go. Let the games begin. I wonder if she'll head for water. We're not too far away from Torchwood Dam, but I'm hoping she doesn't. We don't get very good signal there. But she's definitely on move, and she's heading west in the direction towards Djuma. Now we're just going to let the other vehicle catch up with her first, and then we'll follow slowly behind. Okay, are you ready to bumble? The other vehicle's moved, so we're just going to slowly see if we can keep up with her. Oh, we're not... follow. So we'll give you some last visuals. She's right here, and then we may have to reposition. There you go. So we will do our very, very best here to keep up with her, and we're going to send you guys to some other live location.
So, as Lauren's leopard has moved out of sight, we are currently hoping for any signs of a leopard. It's cooled down drastically now, and we've been sticking to the riverbed inside the river, which is one of the best things about Ngala, is that we have the chance to drive the Thembavati riverbed. And now, the river makes a huge bend in this area, so there's a big, big block full of very, very thick bushveld, or riverine forest, actually. So we're going to skip across this block, use the roads, and then head back down into the riverbed, where we're hoping that we might find a late afternoon chance that the leopard might come down to the cooler part of the riverbed. And that way also have quite a nice view of the area and possibly even go for a drink of water there. It's been fairly quiet over the last few minutes. We have seen one or two elephants moving off. But I think the animals have just started getting more and more active. Some impala and wildebeest up ahead. And then just casually feeding. Have a look at the wildebeest at the back. None of them's even got their heads up. It looks like there's a few younger ones. So this must be a herd. And that impala over there, which looks to me like about a yearling, maybe from last year's lambing season. And that impala just had a quick look, see if there's anything nearby. Like I said, we are not far from the Thembavati. And there's quite dense riverine sections, but in the direction that that wildebeest is facing, there's a large clearing. And it's more than likely the area where they might spend their night. It's nice and open. At the moment, the cloud cover's moved off. And the moon is starting to get brighter and brighter, which means that once the animals have adjusted their eyesight to the low light conditions at nighttime, they might be able to pick up on any movement nearby of potential predators, like the hyenas. They're also utilizing this last little bit of light. The sun's already hidden away behind the clouds in the distance. And that's why they look like they're frantically eating. Just have a look at that sunset. Unbelievable. What a spectacle the clouds and the sun in the late afternoon with the last light creates. But once that sun's down and the light's gone, that's when the predators start to prowl. The lion, the leopard, the hyena. In this particular area, there's a lot of hyena moving around at nighttime. And we have been seeing quite a few hyenas out today. And what I found personally is also that the humid weather does have an effect on the animals' behavior. It makes them really active. But I think we're gonna move on and head back towards the riverbed.
Correct, the animals do become more active, or at least the nocturnal ones. The diurnal ones do not, of course. And there's interesting dynamics between the two when you look at an ecosystem. And the diurnal species are getting ready to rest for the night, and the nocturnal species are getting ready to wake up for the night. It's an interesting time, especially on the coral reef, when all those fish are getting ready to hide or make little spit bubbles or find a hole in a rock. And then all the nocturnal fish, all the predators come out. It's a very energetic time to be snorkeling on coral reef, and it's also a very energetic time to be out here. Tandy's getting more and more active. Now, there's a drainage line in front of us, everyone, and we won't follow her. I don't think it's the wisest idea. It's getting dark. We'll just let her. Hopefully she'll hunt successfully. She's definitely interested in something. And I'm going to try and race Ferrari Safari round to the hyena den to see if it's active. Although it's still very hot, so I don't hold much hopes. But I do check every single day. See the tail's twitching when we're just talking about the tail? So she's not really communicating, but she's concentrating very much. She's hungry. She's got to find dinner tonight. She goes into the thicket. And we obviously just got asked, how are leopards difficult to find? And that's why. You see how easily she blends in. I can't see her with my naked eye. So everyone, we are going to leave Tandy now. And I'm going to race back to Djuma and very hopefully find this hyena den active.
Welcome back to Tswalu. Beautiful spot over here. We're just absorbing the vast scenery, and we're utilizing this vantage point in search of any cats, especially cheetah. And good luck to Lauren finding those hyenas. I'm sure she'll be successful. But this is a brilliant spot to scan for any animal activity. So far, you can almost see into tomorrow. See for days out here. Some oryx and wildebeest in the distance. We have now exited that little exit. We have now left the Terminalia forest and we are venturing south now. We're going to start going through the little dunes over here to see if we can run into any beautiful animals. So imagine walking back in the day. Imagine being an early inhabitant of Southern Africa and having to move over this vast landscape. And it's truly breathtaking now when we're in a nice Land Rover and we can get from point A to point B fairly quickly. But imagine just using your 2 feet and having to cross this vast open area. You really gotta have, you know, you really gotta share and have a lot of respect for people that were inhabiting these harsher areas of South Africa. It must have been very, very tough. There's an oryx gonna cross in front of us here, Dave. It's a beautiful oryx here in the middle of the road in front of us. Looks like a bull. Yes, it is. And this is one animal that is very well suited to these harder environments. You can see his horns are quite short and quite thick around the base section. He's got quite a big tummy. But just rule of thumb, if you see antelope by themselves, generally they'll be a male. Females like to hang in herds, like to associate themselves with other females. It's a slight bell shape within the horns, a bend within the horn structure itself, so a clear indication that it's a male. He's also got a hairy belly button. What a magnificent animal. And those horns obviously being formidable weapons to keep that animal alive out here, so if a predator had to rush up and give it a go, those horns will be very invaluable tools to ward off predators. The Koranaberg starting to put its afternoon or evening dress on. You can see all the shadows. He's hiding from us. Just a very beautiful scene. So a good scan we've given here. Nothing out and about, so we're gonna continue further south along this cut line. And we're gonna be utilizing the road, looking for any tracks crossing from right to left. And with tracking here on Tswalu, it's an invaluable tool for us to find animals. Not that we found many tracks today. See single animals dotted throughout the landscape. Stuck in bed, how often do I pinch myself? Every single day being out here. We are very, very lucky and it is literally like living a dream. I mean, what we get to experience on a day-to-day basis is truly remarkable, and what Tswalu has done here over the years is preserving and protecting all this beautiful diversity, if I can say that, from vegetation to insects, landscape, you name it. So it is really a huge privilege and we are very, very lucky. But it's wonderful that you could join and share, and we could share this with you guys. Just the colors from orange, light brown, green, dark brown of the mountains, the blue sky. It's just endless, constant eye candy, even if there are no animals. But
This is a brilliant spot for predators to sneak up onto animals. Obviously, there's enough cover. From a very in-depth scan of you that we've given this area now, I don't see anything, which is okay. Distance, you can see the undulating landscape of the dunes before those beautiful mountains. It's just remarkable. We're going to continue on south here. Let's start up the old horse. Let's go down the dune. I hope everybody's holding on. We're going to go through a slight little lean here to the left hand side. Are you holding on there, Dave?
Yep.
Obviously very important when it comes to driving like this, you never want your foot on the clutch. You want to control the vehicle with the brake. If you engage the clutch, that means that the vehicle is running rogue, and that's not safe. So obviously safety, like I've always mentioned, is number one, and you let the vehicle and the gear do all the hard work here, basically. And once you're on a bit of a flatter surface, then we can engage a higher gear, and we're off. Just the way that the light is kissing the vegetation now is quite remarkable. Nice bit of activity from an art park last night. Let's close it up a bit. Animals were really busy on this road. Obviously using their remarkable digging ability to unearth all their favorite foods. What a hole. Sure, look at that on the right, Dave. Look at that. It's gonna stop there so you folks can appreciate that and the noisy landy can dissipate and we can just tap into those beautiful earthy sounds. Wow, look at all the spider webs on the grass, Dave. See that? It's a little bit hard. So on the grass itself, you can just see all these illuminated strands waving within the wind. And those are strands from spiders, more than likely spiderlings. Obviously, efficient way of getting from point A to point B, sending out a strand, allowing the wind to take it. And once that strand is anchored on another point, that spider then can make its way across that protein line. And then we've got the dominance of blackthorns. That strip of green there, that is an impenetrable thicket of blackthorn. A very prominent medium to small shrub here on Tswalu. Especially in the section that we are in now. And if you go through Tswalu, 11 different vegetative groups. Depending where you are, close to the mountains, far from the mountains, in the dunes, far in the south, vegetation grows accordingly to the rainfall, which works at a gradient from the southwestern corner to the northeastern corner, which is incredible to see this ever-changing format of vegetation. Red crested coran calling in the distance. Just watch that side, David. Might fly up.
Right, we're going to send you off to our colleagues and another part of this beautiful continent. We'll see you shortly.
Now, I'm hoping that you can just get a sense of the sort of scenic skies we can see tonight. Pink, fluffy clouds. So although we can't see the sun setting, it's very dramatic at our side. So we thought, let's just sit here. You can all sit with us and enjoy the sounds of the bush.
And we're still driving the riverbed. We're driving one of the tributaries into the Timbavati now, having a look for any smaller nighttime creatures, actually. Not necessarily leopard. You can hear some of the birds settling in. Every now and again we catch a pile of elephant dung that surprises us, and it looks like something laying down in the riverbed when it's not. Now, this particular tributary, the water table under the sand is quite high, so I find that the elephants come here often to come and dig for water, and the water's fresh, it's nice and cool during the heat of the day. As it ciphers through the sand, it also gets clean. So, in reality, even us, we can drink it. But it does make it a little bit difficult when you drive this section, because if you don't watch out, you might drive into one of the deeper ones and get stuck. Now, up ahead, there's a section where there's a very big tree, and there's one of the female leopards in the area that used to use that tree often when she was young. So I'm hoping for a bit of luck. I haven't seen any signs of her tracks over the last few days, and I thought we might see some after the rains when she'd go out and patrol. But no luck as of yet. But after dark, these dry riverbeds become very, very active, with lots of predators. Also the African civet, smaller cats like the African wildcat. But I have to say, because of the heat that built up during a day in the sand, it's still very, very hot. So I think we're more likely to find animals up on the bank. And then, of course, we have the elephants making life just that little bit harder by pushing over a tree across the dry riverbed or across the road every now and again. Sometimes they might even go as far as to take one of the trees that's already pushed over and we removed and push it back into the road. There's always a chance that there is something smaller of a nocturnal nature hiding in the tall grass on the banks of the riverbed. Samova? There, if I hear your question correctly, do we have any concerns about being out after dark? Not really. It is different and we need to be careful after dark, but it is also quite fun because you see behavior from animals that you normally wouldn't see during a daytime, especially animals that's more active at nighttime. Most of the nocturnal animals, we just know that they move around here. We don't really know that much about their behavior. And the only way to see that is after dark.
Welcome back. We have gone about a half a kilometer south on that long straight road that you guys folks were with us. Now we've just stopped because we are hearing an amazing bird, a red-crested coran. Myself and David are really trying to get a spot in where we can view and show you guys this magnificent display. But in the meantime, we're just going to take a look at these lovely things. Look at that. So you folks would have seen from flowers, those beautiful pom-pom-like flowers covering the entire tree. This is the seed pod from the blackthorn. So quite remarkable how you folks would have seen from flower and then after flower now producing beautiful seeds. 2 to 3 seeds in these seed pods, and they actually split when they dry. There you can see one splitting quite nicely, and that obviously deposits the seed. There's a little seed tucked away inside there. Just look right at Dev. Just watch it. It is such a tricky thing, and myself and David are trying to formulate a plan on how we can catch this bird in full display. So this bird calls, giving that single sharp whistle a couple of times, and then it flies vertically for about 30-40 meters, and then at its peak it actually rolls to its back and then descends backwards towards the ground, and then a couple of meters above the ground then opens up its wings and lands. But it's a remarkable display to see, and we really hope that we can catch along the lines. But just really nice to see now, if you folks look over here, if David can bring you back the side, you can see how productive this tree really is at producing a vast amount of seeds. And that ensures that your genetic value or code is then taken out, and it is just very, very successful. They're all dried up now, so that is the part in which seed dispersal will happen. Then falling onto the ground, you can see how that seed was actually sticking to the pod casing itself. That pod casing then becomes a transport vessel, because if the wind blows it, it gets rolled on the ground and it disperses from this parent tree, or this mother tree, let's say that. And then obviously you'll have little saplings growing in other areas. And it's taken fairly easy by the wind, if I can just show you over here. Just watch out the wind. I mean, look at that. Just by the wind of my breath, that is taken very, very easily. So you can imagine how important of a factor wind really is to move and redistribute a lot of items in the bush. Sometimes it is a little uncomfortable, let's so to say, for tracking and birding and fishing, and some people just don't like wind in general, but it is a very, very important factor that drives a lot of things out here.
We have just arrived at Ferrari Safari. And look who we have here. I think this is Corky's daughter, and we can actually get such a wonderful look at the spot pattern with the infrared light in Ngwazi and Shimbulu. We don't have any artificial lights on, and sadly there's no adults. So we're going to give you another look for about 20 more seconds, because we've just arrived. Oh, what's that wonderful impala horn? I wonder where that came from. So yes, unfortunately, as you know, we don't stay here without any adults, and I think they're just outside today and waiting for them. It's cool enough now, it's dark enough. The sun's almost gone down, and just like Tandy, the hyenas are nocturnal. So bye, everyone. It was so lovely to see you. No, don't come close to the car. Nope. We are leaving. I am sorry. Bye. Breaks my heart every time. But that is us leaving now, and hopefully tomorrow this den will be active.
Well, welcome back to Tswalu. Welcome. We're just meandering just very slowly here. We had something run across the road. It might have been a steenbok. It was very quick, and they are lightning fast. We're just going to take a look at the tracks to see what it was, and it was a steenbokkie. Okay. We're just enjoying all the birds settling down. Obviously, they'll also start slowing down now, finding a spot where they feel most comfortable. And we're just taking our time, and we're looking very carefully in and amongst all this vegetation to see if we cannot pick something else. Been very slow today, but that's okay. We've had a chance to absorb and really get in touch with Tswalu's landscape, which is absolutely breathtaking. And sometimes you just need those types of drives to really get tapped into the more subtle forms of nature. Beautiful white-browed sparrow weavers' nests. The backdrop with the sun. This beautiful acacia tree. It also come back to, there we go. Is that one? Yes, that is it. That also come back to their nest. Now that one's actually got nesting material. And up to the nest. Beautiful call.
and everything just slowing down now. So this is where obviously all the daytime animals will hang up their boots for the day, and all these nocturnal creatures will start emerging in the next hour or so. Basically a shift in animal activity and animal species. That's very important that you have animals operating at different time frames. So animals utilize different sources of food, utilize different areas, behavior is different. So that it really allows the environment to cope with a high load of animal activity. It's a very complex, interconnected, interwoven system. Love you. The setting sun is just magnificent. Just to watch it like that go down, it shows you how fast we are spinning around it. Do you find this landscape very ancient? Yeah. The soil, the alluvial soil here, the moving soil, the sand found in the western sections of Tswalu is from many different origins. So it comes from other places of Africa, and it some of the soil is very, very old. Even the rocks that make up the mountains here date back to like a billion odd years, which is incredible to think about, you know, the formation of the rocks, and then obviously where all the sand comes from, coming from different parts of Africa, different parts of northwest Western Africa, which is incredible, all the sand being blown in here. And then I love to think about people moving over this landscape and how many footprints have been left here. And we're just meandering through in a Land Rover, streaming live footage of this wonderful and diverse area. And it mind boggles me sometimes. But yeah, I find it a very ancient landscape. It's almost soothing, it's almost calming in its own respect. Some places do have an effect like that on us as humans. For me, it's the ocean and parts of Tswalu. Give me a sense of calm. So those white-browed sparrow weavers settling down, they'll find their nest chambers and their roosting chambers. Having a little bit of communication, here comes another one with more nesting material. Beautiful call, very, very distinctive call. Can't muddle up with any other bird here in Tswalu. Sharp, shrilling, jumbled notes. Very, very distinctive. And this is one of many colonies that we'd find throughout Tswalu. And their breeding behavior is quite unique. Obviously forming a colony like this and everybody partaking and having a certain role, so to say, within the colony. As a colony, they actively defend the site, and only that one pair, that alpha pair, breeds, which is remarkable to think about other individuals helping you out to successfully raise your chicks. It's getting a little chilly now. See, David's put his jacket on. I'm starting to shiver. It's that wind, the chill fact. The wind chill is a very strong thing when out in the veld. And what a remarkable day it's been. Say thank you to the sun again for all of its energy and light, obviously vital for us. Something that needs to be appreciated more often. It's very, very important. Well, from our side over here, it's been wonderful having you guys on board here at Tswalu Kalahari, from myself and David, and then all of our colleagues are across the continent. To be able to share their knowledge and their passion with you folks is wonderful. So be sure to join us for the Sunrise Safari tomorrow. And until then, we'll see you later.
Come on.